Subject of the day today in our care collab video together with Patricia's orchids is Cattleya Maxima. And I will say this, probably for many of my orchids, this is one of my favorites. It's very difficult for me to determine a favorite orchid or not. It seems like every time I talk about an orchid, I say I love this orchid, it's my favorite, and all that good stuff. But yeah, Cattleya Maxima is one of the top five ranked orchids in my collection, and I am so pleased to have her. Thank you for clicking on this video. I really, really appreciate it. I am in southern Spain, so that's quite a ways away from where this one comes from, between Venezuela and southern Peru. I have to say that we're definitely in different time zones. The fact that I had this orchid since early 2018 has given it plenty of time to get over orchid jet lag and settle into its new climate. I got it as a very, very poor and sad division from the back. It was sold to me as blooming size, but you know, once you divide an orchid, everything has to start again. But I managed to get it to grow a very, very poor little growth, but that growth gave me new roots, and that's all we needed. And I have to do a big shout out to Rick L. Because of him, this orchid lives and made it. Because of his techniques, his advice with regards to the teabag method, which I followed, and then the CalMag and the foliar feeding, this orchid is alive because of that. Because the division that I got was really nothing exciting and actually quite scary. That was in 2018. And in 2019, I had her bloom. Beautiful, gorgeous, gorgeous, fragrant blooms, large, hot pink, you know, with the classic striations of a Maxima. It was just a delight for sore eyes. When I saw the buds come, I was nervous, of course, because I wanted to see the blooms, but I didn't know if the orchid was strong enough, which just brings me to the vigor of this orchid, that once she is established and gets going, she is a vigorous orchid. And for her to bloom a year after I received her in such a poor state is nothing but a miracle in my eyes for me, but it shows how vigorous and capable this orchid is to come out of nowhere and start to perform. Her transition clearly into the self-watering setup that I have was absolutely no problem at all either. When the new roots came, she went straight into the pot with Leca and self-watering. And that is the easiest way to do it, to transition any orchid. If the setup is of interest, when new roots come, then there's no need to worry about any roots dying away and having to do a transition with dead roots. New roots into Leca, self-watering, and the orchid won't know any different. Since 2019, I had to then repot her because she got too big for that pot. So within 2 years, I repotted her. And that brings me to, I think it was September of 20 that I had to repot her because I wanted to make room for new growth and all the roots that were coming. By that time, she was already in sheath again. She had matured her three growths of the season and again in sheath. And I didn't get blooms from her last year, which is probably what I'm going to boil down to the fact I repotted her while in sheath. My main focus were the roots. The health of the orchid is in the root system. And I didn't want to, yeah, I wanted her to bloom, but I didn't want to risk having her bloom and then I've got a problem with the roots already so settled in the pot that now I struggle to get her out and I'm gonna set her back. So I took the roots as priority and potted her into this larger pot. And now, you know, I didn't get any blooms last year, but there have been bumps in the sheaths since November. So maybe she's just holding her own until the warmer climate arrives and then she can bloom. Maybe we will get blooms with her when the next new growths that you see down here, when they start to grow and mature, and then we have a mass blooming. I don't know. My first blooming with her was right after the new growths matured, and she gave me 5 flowers in total. This being the upland version, I'm guessing, but the upland version is a smaller form of the lowland type. The lowland type can get up to 70 centimeters from suitable to the tip of the leaf. This one is about 50. So I'm guessing I have the upland type here as the Maxima goes. And for that reason, I can get 4 to 6 blooms per growth, whereas the lowland type, if you have that one, or if you see that one on the market, they can go from 12 to 25 blooms per growth, which is pretty impressive, but they are considered gigantic in comparison to, let's say, the upland type. I'm guessing I have the upland type. It wasn't specified. And when I look at Cattleya Maximas out there in case I want to get another one, they never specify upland or lowland type. It's just when they say the size of the orchid that you can sort of gauge an idea as to which one you will be getting. But for me, the size is perfect. If she were to be any bigger, then I would probably have issues with regards to be able to accommodate her size. I've only ever achieved 3 blooms per growth, sometimes 2, because I had 2 growths mature in 2019 that did bloom. I had 5 blooms in total, which was awesome. I mean, I wasn't expecting this orchid even to make it. So within 12 months, I had blooms. For me, that is fantastic. Now I give her, as you can see by the pseudo bulbs, I give her a lot of light. Being in southern Spain, that is all relative. I try to keep her away from direct sun, but she is in a south-facing orientation on the shelf, which I call my blooming alley, and she is behind a white curtain. And that is a lot of light, even though it is shade. She has her fixed spot. Now, at this point in time, we are first week of February, she lives outside. But when the temperatures drop below 13 degrees Celsius, that is when I will bring her inside. It's not like she couldn't handle those temperatures, but my grow method with the Leca and self-watering has an effect, which is this evaporative cooling, and I don't want those roots to get too cold. If my ambient air is around 15, I am extremely conservative with regards to how many degrees the variables are in my pot. So I will exaggerate and say there's a 3-degree difference and make sure that my orchid doesn't get too cold around the root system because of her setup. But I also have extremely low humidity in the summers, which for this orchid is quite important to have it in a high humidity environment, and I can't provide that. So this setup is working for me very well. It is not 100% ideal, because if I zoom in, you will see that the root tips, some of them have dried back against the dry Leca right there. That's one, for example. So I'm always mindful of spraying the surface of the Leca to keep it moist in order for the roots not to die back. And because of my dry climate, there is this risk or reward concept where I could risk new growths. There's one swelling there. I could risk that by always spraying the surface of the media in order to save my roots, or I just mist as best as I can and try not to get to the base in order to save the growth and the new roots. And then sometimes I have this collateral damage and I will burn a root tip simply because I can't get in there close enough with a sprayer without possibly doing damage to the orchid. And I find this extremely more so the case in the winter, because clearly I don't want to be spraying radically along the base of the orchid while the roots are growing, and possibly with the cold temperatures then risk something happening on the rhizome. So I call it collateral damage. I have 90% of my roots going into the pot. No problem, I lost a root tip. As long as I've got the majority of the roots going into the media, that's fine by me. But yeah, in the summer I have to spray a lot around this orchid just to keep the humidity up so that she has what she needs with regards to the exchange of dehydration with my hot winds and her leaves. So I'm quite busy spraying her. But that is in my climate. I have extremely hot winds that I need to counteract, and I do not supplement with a humidifier, whether it be winter or in summer. I do not supplement with heat mats either, and so far she has been doing really well. Considering she's called the Christmas orchid in Peru, yeah, Christmas has been and gone, and I still don't have my blooms from last year that I was expecting. And she's pushing a new growth already. I don't think this growth is going to develop very, very quickly, but you know, depending on the temperatures, I am sure that eventually while it warms up, she will start going again. Normally I get one growth per lead, but in 2020, she matured this growth here first, the one with the dried sheath, and then shot out two more after this one matured, which is pretty cool. I now have three leads on this orchid. Like I said, she is super, super vigorous. I'm really sorry about any background noise you might hear. I'm gonna try and filter it out, but if you hear the gate clanging, then I do apologize for that. Now, when it comes to what I do to keep her happy, for first of all, I mentioned the light. For me, it is extremely bright shade. Then I fertilize full on when she's in active growth at 300 parts per million, every time she drinks up that reservoir. When she's drunk up that reservoir, I go in and I take the outer mask and I flush her through twice using the outer mask as my measurement with plain RO water only. And then I fill up the reservoir in the summer to the brim as much as I can, which is probably about down here, and with fertilized water again. So she is constantly getting fertilized water when in active growth. And that includes until her sheaths appear and everything, until the growth is fully matured, including the sheaths, I keep fertilizing. After that, I stop simply because she hasn't started producing roots yet. The roots normally grow after this growth has matured. That's when she chucks out new roots. And that is a conundrum when it comes to repotting. Favor the roots, you might risk losing a season of blooming. Favor the sheath, you might have an issue with the roots. I believe she will bloom for me sometime early summer. I do believe so. And then possibly another flush come out in September, October, when she was blooming for me in 2019. I mentioned at the beginning possible jet lag. It could be that that was the jet lag in 2019, and now she's found her mojo and her rhythm. The updates are going to be interesting. I do love those blooms. I love the hot pink. They are super fragrant. They have this amazing, elegant fragrance of roses. And I mean, I like the smell of roses, but I find they all smell the same. So I have a problem with rose fragrances. But this one is like a unique, elegant, very, very exquisite rose. It's like when you put your nose in there, it's the first time you smell a rose. If you've ever smelled the rose for the first time and you remember that, and you're blown away by its fragrance, then you've smelled hundreds of roses. They're lovely, they smell the same. But then you find another rose that you put your nose in and go, whoa, now this one's different. This one's gorgeous. That is the effect of the bloom here with the Maxima. It's an exquisite rose smell. It's divine. And you don't have to be up close. She's pretty intense in her fragrance, even while outdoors. The blooms last approximately 3 weeks, maybe 4 weeks is pushing it, because it depends on the weather outside. Obviously, in my climate, if there's a hot wind going and we have dry temperatures going for an extended period of time, then I might lose my blooms much, much faster, maybe 3 weeks. Is a guarantee. If I can get her to four, brilliant. But I didn't get her to four when she bloomed in the fall for me of 19. So I don't think that she can last more than 3 weeks. But still, it's a pleasure to have this orchid. And one last little thing, pest-wise, touch wood, symbolically touch wood. I have not had any pest issues on this orchid whatsoever. In the summer of 20, I had more mealybugs than I ever had seen on my orchids before. In the winter of 20, now leading 21, I actually saw signs of baby scale on some of my orchids, on some of my Cattleyas. So I quickly took care of those. I haven't seen them return. This orchid was not affected, but if I see a trend of increased insect activity, I've got a very, very close eye on this one because I don't want anything to happen to it. In the winter, she's on the top shelf of my setup indoors, and she's directly under blurple lights. So even in the winter, I make sure that she gets the maximum amount of light, despite the fact that maybe she's not blooming or anything. But I do hold off on the fertilizer in the winter. This is her status quo now, all winter, and all she's been getting is RO water flushed through twice when she's absorbed the RO water in the reservoir, and that's it. I will not be fertilizing this orchid again until I see these eyes push out much more aggressively, or I see buds pushing through the sheaths. Right now, it's just a diet of RO water. I would like to say thank you very, very much. If you've made it this far on my video, I really appreciate it. I also want to say thank you to Patricia's Orchids, who approached me and said that she has the Maxima. Really, really appreciate that you got in touch with me and that we can do this video together. And if anybody has any further questions regarding how I care for my Maxima that I didn't cover, the points I didn't cover, then please feel free to use the comments section below, and I'd be more than happy to elaborate. If you so happen to have this orchid and want to join in on a CareCollab video in the future, also get in touch with either one of us. My email is in the description below, and then I will add you to the spreadsheet for sporadic future updates on this orchid. It was wonderful to have you here. Thank you very much for watching. I really very much appreciate it. Thank you, Patricia, as well, for participating. Take care, everyone. Stay safe. Bye.